Every year, the Circularity Gap Reporting Initiative measures the circularity of the global economy and identifies opportunities across industries and geographies to accelerate change. Here's what we found this year. Today, our global economy is only 7.2% circular, going down from 9.1% 5 years ago. It is clear that our global economy still relies heavily on virgin materials extracted from the environment. Our linear economic model has led to the overshoot of 5 of the 9 planetary boundaries, meaning that the safe limits for our water, soil, and air are being broken. We've spoken to key experts to learn how a circular economy could reverse this impact.
For all industries, we're operating in a system that is very much built on the principle of take, make, and waste. And considering our planetary boundaries, we need to move to a model that is circular, that closes the loop.
Each planetary boundary is a key service system of the Earth, which keeps our climate stable and our society and civilization stable and running. And the challenge is if you cross one of these boundaries, whether it's climate change or biodiversity loss or the ozone layer, once you cross one, that has catastrophic consequences. But it also has knock-on effects on all the other planetary boundaries.
Linear processes sap natural resources, pollute water, soil, and air, and raise the Earth's temperature to unstable levels.
So it's both our model of consumption and the way we define the way our economy works, both are challenging at the moment. And that's why the move towards a circular economy can really help address both of these problems.
We have identified 4 global systems that put the most pressure on the planet. These systems can become more circular by combining 4 key strategies: using materials less, using materials longer, using materials again, making clean by using regenerative materials and energy.
When you think about systemic level changes, it's difficult to just pinpoint that one innovation would solve it or provide like a great example of wider impact. It's more about how you combine these as a whole.
So carbon is certainly a major component, and most of those impacts sit in the supply chain, the so-called scope 3, so in the manufacturing process. So that is a major impact. But also if we think of dimensions that relate to waste, the fashion industry as a consumable industry is well known for rather short life cycles. So clothes are being utilized for a short amount of time and to a large extent then end up still in landfills.
Boldly pursuing circular strategies in these 4 systems could have the potential to reverse the overshoot of 5 planetary boundaries, bring us back on a pathway of global warming to within 2 degrees, and allow us to fulfill people's needs with just 70% of the materials we use now. In our Circularity Gap Report, we have tailored these solutions to different country profiles that take local context and characteristics into account.
In every CGR, we come up with 3 country profiles. So looking at different country groupings around the world, shift, grow, build. And I think that's really just an acknowledgement of the fact that sort of development is a very dynamic picture. So when we look at how circular economy strategies need to unfold around the world, we really do acknowledge that each country and each country grouping has a specific role to play.
Every country is trying to figure out where it fits in the bigger puzzle. But what you can see, for example, in Latin America, which are a huge exporter of organic, secondary organic resources and waste, and that's completely acceptable for low-income emerging economies which need to grow to provide essential services to their citizens. But in advanced industrialized countries, if we continue to pursue infinite growth, which is linked to material consumption, then the benefits of the circular economy, these really important benefits, start to diminish a lot. And so the real question for the next century is how do we reorientate our economic system to be not based on natural resource consumption and more targeted towards social and human prosperity within the planetary boundaries.
In order to achieve this change globally, we need radical collaboration between policy and business.
Circular business models cannot thrive without the markets, and we won't have the markets unless we create the rules for the marketplace. And this is, in fact, very much what the policymakers can do. If Great. I look at the business side, on the other hand, they are in the driving seat when we kind of try to achieve the goals faster than we are doing at the moment.
So the last 5 years, we've seen tremendous growth in that space on the circularity side, on the innovation side. Clearly, the world is in a crisis on many dimensions, but I feel positive about the momentum we're seeing and positive about the scaling efforts that many of the brands, industry players, and also innovators are now putting forward. So I'm optimistic on that front.
Our Global Circularity Gap Report shows that the bold pursuit of a circular economy can have clear benefits for people and planet. With so many inspirational examples of circular practices, it is time to make circularity mainstream. Download the report and join the circular transition today.